Worshiping with us. We begin our service with a gathering hymn, number 665, Rise, Shining People. We will sing the first three verses while seated, and then we will stand during the fourth verse. Please join us.
Thank you.
Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen.
Hear the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but delights in granting pardon and mercy. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. You are free to love as God loves.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We turn to our Kyrie and we'll do verses 1 and 2 today.
When you obey the Lord your God by observing his commandments and decrees that are written in this book of the law, because you turn to the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Surely this commandment that I am commanding you today is not too hard for you, nor is it too far away. It is not in heaven that you should say, "Who will go up to heaven for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it?" Neither is it beyond the sea that you should say, "Who will cross to the other side of the sea for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it?" No, the word is very near to you. It is in your mouth and in your heart for you to observe. The reading of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll now read together the psalm of the day. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul.
My God, I put my trust in you. Let me not be put
to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me.
Let none who look to you be put to shame. Rather, let those be put to shame who are treacherous.
Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths.
Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. In you I have trusted all the day long.
Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting.
Remember not the sins of my mouth, of my youth, and my transgressions. Remember me according to your steadfast love and for the sake of your goodness, O Lord.
You are gracious and upright, O Lord. Therefore you teach sinners in your way.
You lead the lowly in justice and teach the lowly your way.
All your paths, O Lord, are steadfast love and faithfulness to those who keep your covenant and your testimonies.
Today's second reading is from Colossians. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ in Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. You have heard of this hope before in the word of the truth, the gospel that has come to you. Just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world, so it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learned from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, as you bear fruit in every good work and as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite the assembly to rise for the gospel application. What must I do to inherit eternal life? And he said to him, what is written in the law? What do you read there? And he answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? And Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near, And when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, "Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend." Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? And he said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. So, it's been a weird week and a half for our family, which I don't think surprises anyone. I think weird is kind of like the standard, the normal with me. That's kind of what you guys have come to expect. So kudos, you're not wrong. But for us, it was a weird week for Logan and I to both be ill at the same time and the girls to be healthy. We got some requests like, "Can we paint?" And normally I would only let them paint if we supervise them. And I'm like, "Yeah, sure, go for it." Like a bomb had gone off in our house, random things everywhere. But what isn't weird is that whenever our family gets sick, Logan always gets ill the worst. And I do have his permission to use him as an example. I promise. I asked last night after I had already written my sermon. He gets sick. He stays healthy. Like something in his brain is like, we push through everything until all of a sudden we get really sick. Maybe you know some people like that. In your household, you just push through everything until that one bug that just gets you down, and then you have to process like an entire year or 6 months worth of illness. Well, Logan spent one afternoon, while he had the chills, laying outside, warming up, trying to get warm, like your blankets just aren't enough and your heating pad isn't, so we tried solar power. I think it worked. But I don't know, when you consider yourself ill, and maybe you're ill enough to feel like you're the dying man on the side of the road, the Samaritan is always someone you least expect is going to come take care of you. Logan's laying outside, getting over COVID. You know, at this point, like, we're separated. The girls and I are doing our own thing. And Logan is laying outside, and he opens his eyes, and there's a deer right next to him. And I was like, you know, unless this is a Disney movie, and this is Snow White, and the animals in the forest are taken care of, our princess, I do not think that we imagine the people of creation that are going to care for us when we're sick are woodland creatures. It's the stuff of lore and legends. What isn't surprising, though, is when we get sick and we can't get our bodies to do what we want them to do. You get sick and you're like, "Oh, I should be over this thing now. I should be able to be better." On paper, Logan should be the healthiest. He is the most fit. He swims a couple miles every week. I eat my weight in Oreos. Like, he eats salads, and my exercise is like walking up and down the stairs maybe once or twice a week. He should, on paper, recover better and faster than I. Mikan, 24 hours with COVID, and she was acting just fine. Isn't it hard? Like, we're at this stage where we're not blaming each other for catching COVID or passing COVID anymore. Like, that was an unfortunate beginning scenario of a pandemic. But we are at that point where when you don't have anyone else to blame, we become very efficient at blaming ourselves. Like, what's wrong with me? Why can't I do this? Same as, like, why couldn't I ever get good grades in math? Well, if I had studied, maybe I would have gotten passing grades. I don't think I've ever been great at it. And if you're physically fit and you're healthy, you think, why on the outside doesn't my inside work the same way? And I wonder if this man on the side of the road, I wonder how long he spent blaming the priest who passed him by and the Levite. Or did the man make excuses for them? Oh, the priest and the Levite, you know, they're holy people and they can't be tainted. You know, they have to keep their good, pure standing. They can't come in contact with blood and gore. I wonder if he gave them a pass or if he blamed them and felt betrayed. But I wonder how long it got to the point where he started blaming himself. When we run out of excuses to blame other people for the situations we're in, we blame ourselves, and we're very good at it. I mean, some of the phrases he came up with probably could have been very similar to the ones we use today. You know, maybe I shouldn't have been on the road at this time of the day. You know, I knew better. I should have been traveling with someone else. You know, I shouldn't have talked to strangers, or I should have been more aware of my surroundings. Maybe I dressed too flashy. Maybe I was asking for it. Never has a woman from who grew up in the 90s responded more negatively to that. I don't have Shawnee here giving me the look, so I'm gonna have to imagine that some of you in your head are like, remember that. Maybe he blamed himself. And maybe he could have done things differently. Maybe the reaction would have been the same, or maybe the robbers would have just robbed someone else, and someone else would have gone through the trauma cycle of being passed by when they were very clearly in need. No matter how much he maybe tried to hide it and pretend that he's okay. I don't know if you've done that, been in a car accident, and everyone can see that you totaled your car, but you're standing there pretending like everything's okay, hoping that other people will go by, but clearly, there are times where we can't hide our damage, and we are just desperate for someone to stop and help. And we expect the people from our communities, the people most like us, to help. And when they don't, we turn inward. We tear ourselves down, we blame ourselves, we guilt trip ourselves. We become not only in bondage to sin, but in bondage to despair and fatalistic thinking. When we are young, we imagine, we expect, we assume that we have a bunch of energy. When you're old, we assume we can say whatever we want. I put myself in the old category all the time. And I have heard Mike Nimmerman repeat some phrases that I said during our sick week during COVID, and I'm not real impressed at the version of me I see repeated back at myself. But because we have reached a certain level and we pay our own taxes, we think we can say whatever we want. If we're able and capable, we think that we should always be strong. If we are smart, we assume that we will always be able to have the last say, that our point will always be the deciding factor. If we have money, we assume and we expect that we will have power. So now here is where I'm going to push us a little. Take a deep breath. You guys know me. I'm always going to do my very best to set you down gently on the other side of this example. I am competent, and I should be able to have whatever I want and use it in whatever way I want. I am an adult, and I should be able to be in charge of my own reproductive rights. I am a person of faith, and I know best for my community and my world what they need. You may have heard those phrased in different ways, but we, as most decades and generations before us, have contentious topics that are laws and bills that are being decided and debated. And we as people of faith have to learn how to live best as neighbors in the midst of whichever direction those laws go. Which of all of the 600 laws did this man, this lawyer, one of the lawyers, they knew their stuff. I have a sister-in-law who's prepping for the bar, and I've gotten on my knees to pray for her. Like, I'm having symptomatic, post-traumatic stress from watching my friends study for the bar. Nothing makes you feel more stupid in the world than a big exam that says, if you pass this, we'll let you do the job that you studied for 4 years, and you do for, and if you don't pass, SOL. These lawyers that were testing Jesus would have known the 636 laws of the Old Testament, and they had to whittle it down to which is the most important. Well, to love your God with all your heart and soul and mind, and to love your neighbor as yourself. They knew the answer. They knew how to pass the bar. But still, they wanted to work around it. Well, who is my neighbor? Beautiful thing, when you've encountered God's mercy and forgiveness, is that everyone is your neighbor. You've seen the Unsinkable Molly Brown. There's a scene where they're running around in this big barroom. You're my friend, and you'll stay my friend. Doesn't matter what the other people say. You're my friend, till the bitter end. No? Watch it. I don't know. Find it on Amazon. The Unsinkable Molly Brown. Debbie Reynolds. Brilliant musical. We get to run around, and everyone is our neighbor, and everyone is our friend, till the bitter end. That's a lot. When in theory, you can only have 12 in-depth, meaningful relationships. So we can see all the countless people around us that we can't have really deeply intimate relationships with, that we only have surface level friendships with, and then it's like, that's a guilt trip. that's a terrible setup, God. Why would you give us everyone's our neighbor, but then like only create me to be able to have 12 really successful, meaningful relationships at any given time? Feels a little bit like you set me up to fail. The Olivia Rodrigo song playing in the background. You betrayed me. And I know that I'll never succeed at this. Okay, my caffeine kicked in between first service and second service. I also left my sermon somewhere. So you're getting this ad lib. We assume that because we are one thing on the outside, that we should be able to do other things. And at the same time, we try and create laws that help us love our neighbors the best we possibly can. That's what all those 636 laws in the Old Testament are about, trying to love yourself and your neighbors better. And did they work? Some of them were okay. The most important to love your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. We live in a time, I guess this is the only time I've lived in, and I love history, but I assume that our time isn't that different from all the times before us. We end up falling into the trap that if I'm right about how we pass this law, everything will fall into place. Just like this lawyer. If I'm right and I ask Jesus this, and I get the one that I think is the most important to be confirmed as the most important one, then everything is going to trickle into place. And Jesus says, who is the better neighbor? The Levite? The priest who did everything right and looked good on paper? Or the Samaritan that everyone reviled and everyone excluded and everyone made jokes of and no one was kind to? I mean, think of what is something that's core and central to who you see yourself as. If you are a Hawkeye fan, your best friend and hero is probably not going to come to mind as like the number one Cyclone fan, right? I know that's like an exhausted example, I guess. But sports for me feels like the safe place to like use illustrations. If you are a very comical person, maybe you don't expect that the person who's going to resurrect you is someone who is what we call a Debbie Downer, which is offensive, because those of us who are like sad and mopey and morbid, we're not bad people. We feel betrayed when our bodies and our minds and our hearts do not work the way that we think they're supposed to. And we feel betrayed when the laws that we put all of our hope into do not pan out the way we expect them, the way we will them, the way we want them. And here Christ is in our midst and says, the best way is to show mercy. So nothing is changing about the way the world works. We are still going to be trying to put laws in place that help us love our neighbors better, serve each other better. And of course, I am biased because I am fallible and human. But I'm going to try to not preach that from the pulpit. You guys all spew all of my honesty at the fellowship table where we have coffee, where you can, you know, have to go to the bathroom if you need to. How do we show mercy to each other? How do you show mercy to ourselves? I was pouty and grouchy all of the last week is what I said, but really I was feeling guilty that I got COVID right before I got to lead the worship service down in Sully for the 4th of July. I was excited about that. That's a big deal. And here I'm sick and I'm still supposed to be in my isolation for 5 days. How do I love my neighbors? Well, do I show up and maybe contaminate people? Or do I trust that God is working through all of us and trust that our members down there know how to minister to each other? And they did beautifully. So then I was really pouty for a week. I'm like, nobody needs me. I was like, of course. I'm honored to be extended the call to both of our wonderful congregations. But I felt guilty because I wasn't there. I wasn't doing what I thought I needed to do. And I imagine you guys have those experiences too. When you've gotten sick, or when you bump up against kind of an abrasive relationship or an abrasive personality, like, I can't get you to understand the point of what I'm coming from. Like, I like to collect stuff. I like to walk into my room and see all of my treasures packed there. It's like my baby borderline hoarding. But for me, it's like, oh, I just love to see all of my treasures around me. I want to feel like I'm loved and adored and safe. And poor Logan for 12 years has said, I'm like, you don't need anything. You need a spork and laundry detergent. That's it. I mean, that's a little extreme, but kind of. I'm sorry, I will give you free rein to say embarrassing stories about me always reading day to day, Logan. I promise. How do we show mercy to each other? We can't will each other into understanding our love through legal laws. We do our best to create safe places where we can love each other, but we show mercy. The priest and the Levite, they were trying to honor their religious communities by not getting contaminated. In the best possible light, we can give them their religious integrity. But at the same time, God was very much present on the side of the road, just begging to be taken care of in this person who is beaten and bloody. Are we going to step outside of our protocols to be merciful, to be the hands and the feet of Jesus? That's a question I can't answer for you, but it's a pondering we can all do with integrity and dignity together. How best do we show mercy? How best do we love each other? To love your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. So if you are feeling strong and able, may you be blessed to go forth and be a blessing. If you feel like you are still that dying man on the side of the room, please do not try and hide how you're hurting. Please ask for help so your neighbors can help you. And if it doesn't come from the people you expect, try and be merciful to them. But also, give thanks for how God is going to show up and be faithful to you, because God has made promises to keep you, to prosper you, to help you live. And it shows up often in mercy when we most need it and are most broken down. So the good news, if you feel broken down, God is holding you tenderly. If you're feeling encouraged and strong, you are the hands and feet. You have everything you need to go forth and be the church for a world who needs you. For this good news, we give thanks and we say amen. I invite you to join us and sing our hymn of the day. Please rise as you are able. Thank you. our service continues as we confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
United in Christ and guided by the Spirit, we pray for the church, the creation, and all in need. Good and gracious God, you have placed your word of love in the heart of your church. Fill your church with compassion that we bear the fruit of your healing mercy to the broken world. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
You created the earth with seeds sprouting up to new life. We pray for the flourishing of fruit trees and orchards, vines and bushes. Prosper the work of those who plant, tend, harvest, and gather. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Show us your ways and teach us your paths of justice and love. Raise up community and national leaders to challenge and dismantle societal structures that perpetuate ethnic, racial, and religious profiling and discrimination. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Come near to all in need. Orchestrate kindness in the face of cruelty, hope where there is despair, love in the face of neglect, comfort where there is death, and healing in illness. God, we ask that you be present with those who are encountering turmoil over the changing laws. May we be mercifully, God, to them, seeing them in their hurt and their wounds, loving them through you into wholeness and healing. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Turn this community towards neighbors in need. Bring aid and support to those who are poor, beaten down, abused, forgotten, silenced, or avoided. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the saints who revealed your love and mercy in this life. Inspired by their witness, strengthen us to live in hope. We give thanks especially for the life and the witness of Maxine Schutz. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God, in every time and place, in Jesus' name and filled with your Holy Spirit, we entrust these spoken prayers and those in our hearts into your holy keeping.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please, at this time, I invite you to share a sign of Christ's peace with those around you, as you and your household are able. A peace be with you to those worshiping with us online. You may be seated as we turn to a time of offering.
Thank you.
abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he blessed it and he gave it for all, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come, taste and see that the Lord is good. All are welcome. This is the body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Thank you. body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. If you do not have a mailbox here, they are coming to you in the mail or are being hand delivered. So keep your eyes open for those. Make sure they get filed wherever you put your tax stuff. But those are, check your mailboxes here. Tuesday night, 6 p.m. is council meeting. So those of you who have things you would like the council to discuss on Tuesday, please reach out to myself or a fellow trusted council member and let us know so we can talk about those. We have some prayer requests for Joanne Nida. She is ill in the hospital. They're expecting that she'll be released from the hospital and will do recovery at Park Center. But her family appreciates prayers. They know how much she loves this church and how much we love her. So we thank her family for reaching out and asking for prayer. Yes?
Did you mean New Village?
Mm-hmm. No. Yep.
She's moving to Park Center.
Yep, so if you go visit her, we'll let you know when she gets out of the hospital. Right now, she only gets two visitors a day, and her kids are cycling through, so we'll honor those reserved spots. So when she's out of the hospital, she will be doing recovery at Park Center for a little while, and then, God willing, if she's able, we'll go back to Newton Village, or she'll stay there, and we'll get you updated addresses for those of you who visit her and send her cards. So for now, prayers are greatly appreciated and requested. Game day today? So see you guys at 1:30 for board games and fun, or just fellowship and hanging out. So if you don't have plans, come hang out with us starting at 1:30. Any other announcements? Okay. With that, please rise as you are able and receive a blessing. God of peace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life this day and always. Amen. Amen. Please join us in our sending hymn, Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.